Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to solve exercise 3.76 of the textbook, First Course in Probability. So in this one, we start with a very general experiment. We call E and F two mutually exclusive events attached to this experiment. And now we consider the new experiment that consists in repeating this first experiment until either E or F occurs, and the goal is to compute the probability that E occurs before F. So, just a picture to explain what's going on. We have, let's say, omega here. Omega is, in my picture, the sample space that corresponds to the original experiment. Then you have, we know, two events that we call E and F that are mutually exclusive, so they do not overlap. And clearly, if you do this experiment, it's possible that E and F do not occur. And that what you want to do is to repeat this experiment until one of the two occurs. And the goal is to compute the probability that E occurs before F. So the event of interest is not an event that is a subset of this omega, that's going to be the subset of another omega, another sample space, corresponding to a bigger experiment that consists in reproducing this experiment until E or F occurs. So A is going to be the event that E occurs before F. Okay, so it turns out that we already solved this problem in a specific example. Here we have a general experiment and we have two mutually exclusive events that can be whatever. But in a previous video, we already answered the question in the context where this first experiment consists in rolling two dice. And E is the event that the sum is 5, and F was the event that the sum is 7. The goal was to compute the probability. If you roll those two dice in sequence, what is the probability that you will get a 5 before a 7? So to answer that question, I use the fact that a probability was sigma additive. We were able to write the probability of our event A, in this case, 5 before 7, as an infinite union of mutually exclusive events, and then we use sigma additivity. That was because the question was asked in chapter 2, before we knew about conditional probabilities. Now, we have a similar question, but in a more general context. That's now in chapter 3, so I'm going to give you, I believe, the answer that the author would expect by using conditional probability instead of sigma additivity. But have in mind that this problem or the previous one we did with dice can both be solved either way by using sigma additivity or conditional probability. So in this case, the technique we are going to use to solve the problem is a very traditional technique, very popular technique at some higher level in the field of stochastic processes and especially discrete Markov chain, and that's called first step analysis. The idea of this technique is to condition on what happens at step one. That's what we did already in previous problems where you have experiments in two steps, with two steps, and we condition on what happens at the first step. Here, that's a little bit more tricky because the number of steps is not known. You don't do the experiment twice, you just do it until either E or F occurs, but you can still use this idea of conditioning on the first step. So now what we need to do is condition on different things that can happen at step one, and a natural thing to do because we need for that a partition. A natural thing to do is to call G the event equal to the complement of E union F in such a way that E, F, G form a partition of omega. Now, I'm going to condition, to compute P of A, I'm going to condition on this partition, but now we don't think of E, F, G as strictly speaking, events that are attached to omega. We think of EFG as three possible events that can happen at step one of our bigger experiment. So doing this, I'm going to end up with, and also before we get started, also to simplify the notation, I'm just going to call P and Q the probability of E and probability of F. So let's say that, let me write that here, this is little p, this is little q, that's the two probabilities we have. Then we can start with saying that, well, P of A is going to be equal, because EFG form a partition of the sample space, that's going to be the probability that A occurs. So E occurs first, given that the first thing that happens is E times P of E, okay, plus probability of A, given that F occurs first. Okay, at step one, by first, I mean at step one, and then plus P of A given G times the probability that G occurs first. Okay, so, so we get this expression. Then P of E, P of F are known. We call them little p, little q. So we assume that those ones are known. P of G is easy to compute too, because E, F, G form a partition of omega of the sample space. That means that those three probabilities should add up to one. And so that means also that P of G should be equal to one minus P minus Q. So we get that one also. And conditional probabilities are, those two ones are extremely easy. This one is more difficult. So let's look at those two ones first. So first, what is the probability that E occurs before F if the first thing that happens is E? Well, clearly that's equal to one, okay? If you start with E, then clearly E occurs before F. And so that means that this probability here is equal to one. And then this one at the opposite tells you that the given F occurs at step one, then that's not possible that E is going to occur before F. So that means that this conditional probability here should be zero. Okay? So if you know if at step one E or F occurs, you know from the beginning which of the two occurs first. And so that gives you like those two conditional probabilities equal to one and zero. So that means that this term plus this one, they simplify a lot. And eventually you just get that this is one times P plus zero times Q. And so you just get P, little p. Then what about the last term here? Well, G, we said, because EFG form a partition, then P of G should be equal to 1 minus P of E minus P of F, and so that's equal to 1 minus P minus Q. So that's the probability of G. What about P of A given G? So this one, to get this probability, so this one is slightly more tricky. You use what we call a restart argument or memoryless argument, and argue basically that if the first thing happening is G, okay, then none of those two events occur, and so you can forget about step one. That's why we call that memoryless, and you can restart from step two and just say that, well, what happens at step one doesn't give us any information about whether E or F is going to occur first. So P of A given G should again be equal to P of A. So you see, P of A given G equals P of A tells us basically is equivalent to the fact that A and G are independent. And indeed, it's clear that if G occurs at step one, then that should not affect the probability that E is going to occur before or after F. So by memoryless, you can restart the process starting from step two, and then that tells you that V should be equal to just P of A P of N not plus, that's this product here, that's this number, so you have P of A here. Okay, and then we are almost done. Now you see that eventually we don't have P of A equals a specific expression using only P and Q. P of A appears again, but what you can do is simplify things a little bit. You can subtract by P of A on both sides, so this one disappears, the one here disappears, and then that tells you that P plus minus P minus Q times P of A equals zero. Okay, so eventually we have just this equation, so this becomes wrong because I just simplify it, but without touching this one, but then we have that this expression here, the last line should be equal to zero, and then that tells you clearly that P plus Q times P of A is equal to P, and then from that you conclude that P of A is equal to P divided by P plus Q. P divided by P plus Q. So that's consistent with what we found for the two dice. Rolling the two dice, we were able to prove that the probability of having 5 before 7 was equal to P5 divided by P5 plus P7. Now what plays the role of P5 is P, what plays the role of P7 is Q. So indeed, we have something consistent with the problem we did before about the dice, except that now the approach we used was first step analysis, conditional probabilities, instead of using sigma divisibility of a probability. And you see also that now we have something more general, that's not just example of the two dice, that's in fact true, this property is true for any possible experiment.